I'm very pleased to be able to follow Father Pat for a couple of reasons. First of all, we both have New England antecedents, which became apparent to me listening to him speak. I don't know if any of you others identified the Massachusetts accent. But second of all, like him, I'm a Kennedy Democrat. And third of all, my grandparents were Russian Jews, and so I gesture a lot. Okay. I'm not going to repeat what I said. I'd like to make a couple of comments on predecessor presentations, but first of all, I'd like to introduce Ernesto Caravantes, who's with us from California. Ernesto has written two books that have already been published. A third will be published in the next year or so on the problems of Latinos in the United States and the need for them to move towards the U.S. cultural mainstream away from the Latin American cultural mainstream. You want to stand up, Ernesto? On the subject of Mrs. Hannity, O'Reilly, and Beck, David Brooks had a very important column in the New York Times yesterday or the day before. And David Brooks, of course, is a center-right Republican. And he made it clear that they are fringe elements whose apparent influence is not nearly as great as they seem to think it is. I mention this because I would like for us not to be thinking of them as mouthpieces for our movement. There was mention of a Salvadoran death squads as the reason for Salvadorans being in the United States legitimately. The Salvadoran death squads were aimed exclusively at a few left-wing agitators and not just agitators, left-wing thinkers. And the vast majority, I would say that 99% of the Salvadoran immigrants had nothing to fear from any death squads. Okay, I'm not going to say very much about what the subject that's been assigned to me because my op-ed, which appeared in the Christian Science Monitor and the Baltimore Sun, is in the handout. The title of it is "What Will America Stand For in 2050? The U.S. Should Think Long and Hard About the High Number of Latino Immigrants." But I do want to make some comments about Mark Cromer's very important presentation. Because this article had an odyssey. It started with, I think, the January 30th or 31st Sunday New York Times lead editorial, which used the words xenophobic and nativist to describe anybody who was basically opposed to open borders. I immediately sent an email to the op-ed page editor asking for an opportunity to respond on the op-ed page. I received encouragement, and that started a process that lasted for 2 weeks as the Times sort of chewed on the piece that was subsequently published, the one that's in your packet, and finally was rejected. I then sent it to the Washington Post, which has published pieces, 18 pieces of mine in the last 20 years, and I sent it to David Ignatius, who was the Washington Post Outlook editor back in the 90s, who published a lot of my stuff. He liked it very much, but he said, I don't have any call on this any longer. It's the op-ed page or the Outlook editor who's going to make the decision. The Post chewed on it for another 2 weeks, and it was rejected. At that point, I had a friend who knew he thought he was the op-ed page editor of the Los Angeles Times. He was not. He had been promoted to the deputy editorial page editor. So I sent it to him. He said, let's see what the op-ed page editor thinks about it, and a week later it was rejected. In each case, the circumstances were so close to what Mark Cromer described in terms of the way the editorial page and the news reports mesh with one another, reinforce one another, that it became apparent to me that had they published my op-ed, it would have meant something that would have been unthinkable for them. It would have undermined a basic editorial position that is reinforced in the news reporting. And so I learned a lesson in this odyssey. I sent it to the op-ed page editor of the Christian Science Monitor, who picked it up with alacrity, published it, and it was picked up with alacrity by the Baltimore Sun. And that's all I'm going to tell you, because you can read the piece.